that's associated with that tool, and that tool helps you have that intent. Intent moves consciousness, and we all make up our own tools. And everybody should make up their own tools, because everybody's tools are different. And that's one of the problems with groups that all do one thing. There's this tool set. You know, some master someplace gets real clever and he makes up these tools and he does marvelous things and then he teaches somebody else. And pretty soon the tools become sacred. The tools become, you know, things to worship in themselves. You know, but the tools are just tools. And you can use them or not use them. Now, they may be very effective for you. You know, just like thinking that that beam of light's a laser, it's maybe very effective for me. But I could just as soon have a little fairy wand and put fairy dust on it. If that meant something to me, and I thought that's the way you change things, that's the way Tinkerbell changed things, you know, if I got into that, that would work just as well. So these are tools, and a lot of us will use the same tools. Visual tools are particularly good because visual things are very precise. You get a lot of data in visual things. You can have feeling tools. You don't have to visualize. You can have tools that have nothing to do with visualization, and they'll work too. They're a little harder to get precise because feelings tend to be kind of fuzzy. So that's all. But yeah, most of what you find in different schools of, you know, of practice in healing, whatever, they're tools. There's ways of helping focus your intent, and that's all they are. But if they work for you, good. You know, it's not like, well, they're just tools, you know, get rid of them. No, they are tools. But if some other tool works better for you, develop it. All it's doing is focusing your intent. Another one?
How do you explain Kundalini?
How do you explain it?
Well, no, how would like you explain it with regards to how does it fit in with your theory?
Kundalini is it's kind of a state of being. It is a real thing. Okay, and what it is it's a way of symbolizing a certain level of growth. When you get to a certain level of growth, now you don't have to go through this experience, but particularly if you're in a belief system where Kundalini plays a large part of it, you get to a certain level of growth where you are ready for that step, and this is kind of a rite of passage, if you will. And you feel this and you get this interaction with energy, and it does actually change you, and energy is flowing through your body and all those things are really happening, and you end up on the other side with perhaps a greater awareness. But it's not because there's some magic going on there. It's because you've earned that spot. It's more like a graduation ceremony, I guess I would say, than it is something that just happens to you. You have to get to the level where you want it. Now, having said that, you know there's always exceptions to, you know, to every rule, just like Bob Monroe did out of body because, you know, even if he didn't want to, it just happened to him. Well, that was on his path to experience, so it just happened to him. There are people who just happen to, you know, jump into states that they haven't earned. They're usually there for a little while, come back, or they don't know what to do with them, and they're totally confused. And these things do happen, but they happen on the fringe, and it's rare events for that to happen. Yes, ma'am.
You say that by eliminating fear and ego and lowering entropy, you're becoming love. Can
yes.
You define love. What you mean?
Love is the nature of a low entropy being. When you have eliminated all the fear and ego, and your entropy is very, very low, you are love. In other words, just that low entropy state is the state where you interact with everything through love. Now, if you're not interacting with everything through love, then your entropy isn't as low as it can go. So we look at the larger consciousness, and it's lowering its entropy as we all chug along and help it out. And basically, it exists. It's probably the lowest entropy, this system. You know, we're subsets of it. We're working on lowering entropy, but it's kind of the system that has the low entropy understanding. That system is love. So you could say consciousness is love. Spirituality is working toward being love. And that's the same thing as saying that it's low entropy states. It's just another way of saying it. We're working toward it because that's the way the system works. Every system must evolve. You either evolve, you stay the same, stasis, or you die. Those are the only three things you can do. You can go forward, stay the same, or go backwards. So you're a system, a very complex system, and staying the same is unstable. That never works. You don't stay the same for long. You change. So that means that in the long run, you will either change and devolve and die, or you will evolve. So that's why we're doing it, because, you know, it's evolve or die, basically. And the whole system of consciousness is evolving, and we're part of that evolution. So that's why our purpose is to become love. That's why our purpose is to be more spiritual, because we're part of this system, and we're evolving. It's not, you know, it's not an intellectual thing. It's just what systems do. You know, why did fish grow legs? You know, they just evolved to do it because they needed to, because there was more food out of the water than there was in the water. Well, we evolve in order to survive.
Yes?
How about visiting other realms, lower entropy?
It does not, and it's not any reason to have to do any of that. It's not required. It's not even important. I do that because I'm a physicist and I want to see everything. I want to go everywhere and I want to understand it. So I have explored and made maps, and I keep doing it. It's not important. It's not important that you ever do anything paranormal. It's not like, oh, this person does a lot of paranormal stuff. They must be really well developed. And it's not necessary. You can grow and be a much, you know, very enlightened person and have a lot of power in your consciousness and never do anything that's paranormal. Not required at all. It's possible for you if you're at that level. You can do these things if you want and if you try to learn to do them. You have to put a little effort to learn how to do these things, but they are not important on your process of growing at all. Not required. Yes, sir?
I'm curious to understand more about what Bob taught you back in the early days. Is there something that you can share with us, something practical that we could try out ourselves?
Well, what he taught us, basically the first thing he taught us was, you know, and we did evidential stuff with this all the time. He taught us to do out of body, basically, whenever we wanted to, you know, on command.
How would you do that?
Well, first of all, you have to give up the beliefs that you have. You know, you read Bob's book and he says, well, I rolled out of body, and everybody lies there and goes, they tried to roll, you know. That's not it. You know, it's not like that. You don't have to roll anywhere. It's a matter of focus. It's a matter of where your intent is focused, where your mind is focused. First, do a meditation. Get in a meditation state where your mind is blank, where you are that point of consciousness. When you're in that point of consciousness state, you'll often feel a vibration. It'll be about 4 hertz. You just feel yourself going, you know, like that, vibrating. Enjoy that. And while that's going on, use your intent to go somewhere, to do something, and make it something evidential. Go visit somebody you know that you can call up and say, were you doing this? That's doing remote viewing. Go read numbers on a blackboard in another room. Heal somebody. You know, do all these things and do them enough that you can get decent statistics on whether or not it works. When it works, try to think, where was I? You know, how did I approach that? What was my mindset? What was my attitude? Try to repeat it. It's a trial and error. You have to do it. It takes a long time. It's slow, but it's the only way to learn. Just one tiny increment of time. That's what I mean when I say pull yourself up by your bootstraps. That's kind of a physics term too. You know, where you pull yourself up by your bootstraps, that means you grow in tiny increments. An athlete develops his ability by bootstrapping himself. That means he trains and he practices.